All right, we'll hear argument now in the next case on the calendar, which is 19-72487, Jesus Isaac Villegas-Gomez versus Merrick Garland. And we'll hear first from, Ms. Anderson?
Yes, Your Honor.
Okay, all right, and you have 6 minutes on the clock. You may proceed.
Thank you, Your Honor. Good morning. Caitlin Anderson, pro bono counsel for Petitioner Jesus Villegas-Gomez. I will address PSC, and my colleague Munmi Soni will handle due process and CAT, as well as rebuttal. May it please the court. The particularly serious crime bar strips asylum and withholding protection from those who face persecution outside the United States. In recognition of those severe consequences and in line with the statute, the PSC designation is rightfully reserved for relatively grave offenses. In this court's words, it cannot be applied to a major proportion of convictions. But here, the agency went out of its way to find Jesus' misdemeanor conviction for possession of a dirk or dagger was particularly serious. That finding rested on two fundamental legal errors. First, the agency improperly considered Jesus' dismissed charges as part of a threshold inquiry into the nature of the conviction. And second, it misapplied Gomez-Sanchez v. Sessions. Turning to the first error, the board's precedent is clear that the nature of the conviction refers to the elements of the offense, and that inquiry serves a gatekeeping function.
That the agency could properly consider the bicycle incident, the underlying conduct involving the bicycle?
So, Your Honor, our position is that the agency was first required to consider the elements of Penal Code Section 21310, which is the possession of a dirk or dagger statute.
Look at that in isolation. It wouldn't seem that the, application of force, kicking the bicycle would be relevant to that. That's my question. Is it relevant for the agency to consider the full context of the conduct in which the charged possession occurred?
Only if the agency first conducted the threshold inquiry and determined that 21310 brought the offense into the category of PSCs. And then, yes, it could consider the underlying facts and circumstances, which in this case were that he kicked a man's bicycle.
What does the record say about, was the man on the bicycle when it was kicked, or was he standing next to it?
I believe he was walking his bicycle out of the metro station, and Jesus had offered for the man to exit first, and the man refused, and Jesus, in line with the expert testimony that shows he is incapable of handling many social situations, became somewhat aggravated, and that led to this incident. So here, the agency should have considered the elements of 21310 first, and if the elements of the offense under matter of NAM do not potentially bring the crime into the category of PSCs, the facts and circumstances are of no consequence. So here, the agency should have ended its analysis after looking at the statute of conviction, but that's not what it did. At AR4, the board discusses the nature of the conviction and refers to Jesus's dismissed charges, which it describes as inherently dangerous and violent. So that alone would warrant remand here, but the board additionally erred in upholding the IJ's infirm Gomez-Sanchez v. Sessions analysis.
Before we get there, does the record say anything about what happened to the man with the bicycle as a result of the bicycle being kicked?
The IJ finds that the man was not harmed, which would weigh against finding a PSC here.
Was he knocked over? Does it say anything at all about what happened to him in the record?
There was no contact between, there's no evidence of any contact between Jesus and the man's person, just the bicycle. So turning to the Gomez-Sanchez v. Sessions analysis, here the agency failed to give reasoned consideration to dispositive evidence that shows his intent and culpability were undercut by his mental illness and disability. The psychological expert testified, this is at 275, that he isn't the type of individual who is intentionally aggressive. He's just misperceiving and doesn't know how to respond appropriately in certain social situations, especially situations of conflict. But the IJ does not recognize this type of evidence at all and just refers to his diagnosis and finds that that evidence did not mitigate his offense. But that is in conflict with Gomez-Sanchez v. Sessions, which overturned the board's holdings that mental illness does not lessen the danger actions respondents' actions posed. And so here the court, the IJ and the board were really parroting the same explanation that this court has already reversed in Gomez-Sanchez v. Sessions. And with that, if there are no further questions.
Something that's troubling me here and is the fact that this gentleman spent 364 days in jail, which seems like a long time for this no-lo plea for this particular offense. And is that just a fact that he apparently it took that long to get him for this plea to be negotiated? But I wouldn't, in the ordinary course, wouldn't expect a sentence of that long of a period of time for this offense as it stands. On the other hand, when you consider the other facts that are in the background here going on, then the other background facts in connection with the other charges actually certainly make the situation more serious than the nominal no-lo plea.
Well, 2 points, Your Honor. First, a doubt was declared as to his competency within days of his arrest, and so he was sent to California's Patent Hospital for Competency Restoration Services. And for that reason, by the time his plea was negotiated, he had already accrued, I think, over 600 days of custody credit. So the length of his sentence may reflect that he already had served that time. And additionally, the board's precedent has weighed in on this factor and says that the length of the sentence imposed isn't the most important factor in the PSC analysis. And second, the dismissed charges are improper, should not be considered even in the all reliable evidence inquiry because they don't speak to the conviction. Alaka, a Third Circuit case, has weighed in on this, but even the Ninth Circuit's case holding in Flores-Vega v. Should provide some help to the court on this front, because there the court held that the elements of the conviction could not be used to establish the facts that the PSC analysis would be based on. And here, if the agency looks to the dismissed charges to try to extrapolate facts, that would be even one step further than what Flores-Vega has already condemned. And with that, I will pass this over to my colleague.
Thank you.
Good morning, Your Honor. My name is Manmeet Soni, and I would like to reserve 3 minutes for rebuttal. Your Honors, remand is additionally necessary to cure the due process and legal errors infecting the CAT claim. Beginning with the due process errors, which are twofold. The first one begins with the agency's improper reliance on Jesus's incompetent testimony. And this is an issue that the government waives challenge on, and rightfully so, because here the agency had granted Mr. Jesus the procedural safeguard under matter of JRRA saying that it would not rely on his unreliable testimony to evaluate whether he had met his burden of proof. That instead, in pursuant to that procedural safeguard, it would look to the objective evidence. And that's exactly what the agency did not do. And instead relied on his incompetent testimony to find that he did not meet his burden of proof. That alone, Your Honor, is grounds for a remand. Second, the second due process error concerns the agency's failure here to give reasoned consideration to dispositive evidence. And that dispositive evidence is two expert opinions, who both of who testified were deemed credible, the father's declaration, as well as extensive country and medical reports, none of which is addressed by the board in its decision or in the IJ's decision. And whereas here, there's a serious disconnect between what the objective evidence was, as well as with the IJ's findings, this court remands. Finally, Your Honor, this is yet another case where the board misapplies this court's precedent from Villegas v. Mukasey and Cole v. Holder. The board construes this court's decision in Villegas v. Mukasey as creating an exemption for mental health care workers, despite recognizing, and here the IJ made this finding and the government itself concedes, that the harm that's existing inside these mental health institutions that Jesus himself fears constitutes, rises to the level of torture. The board finds that under Villegas v. Mukasey, specific intent need not be found. And that is an over-reliance on Villegas, because that's not what this decision holds, nor what the Convention Against Torture tolerates. The second error with respect to this court's precedent flows from
what is— Are you saying that there's no scienter requirement, or that it's a lesser one? Or is it objective? What is your standard?
Yes, Your Honor, it is, it's well, in this case, the IJ, you're right to say, is relying on what the people who are involved in torture are saying about why they're doing what they're doing. And that type of state sanctioning is absolutely prohibited by this court's precedent and the convention. In a scenario like this, where an applicant fears future torture, the workers are not being put to trial here, and the evidence that's before the court requires that they look to the circumstantial evidence and draw inferences, which is what the agency is not doing. Instead, it's relying on Villegas, it's relying on matter of JRGP, saying that it's foreclosed from having to do that because this harm is occurring inside mental health institutions. But the objective, I mean, the evidence is uncontested, it's objective insofar as the record shows and the global medical community agrees that the type of harm that they're subjecting psychiatric patients to, it's not for purposes of a treatment, it's not rehabilitation. You don't tie someone up on a wheelchair for years at a time where you know that it's inflicting extreme pain and suffering, and you're doing it for purposes of a prescribed purpose, which is punishment and control. That qualifies and meets the elements and the requirements under what constitutes torture.
Since our decision in Villegas versus Mukasey, haven't we at least implicitly held that specific intent is required? And I mean, are you arguing that this case should be taken en banc to reverse Villegas v. Mukasey?
No, Your Honor. We are not challenging that we need to demonstrate specific intent. Absolutely. And we've taken that burden very seriously in this case, which is why we have two experts who've testified, and we have extensive country conditions evidence to document that. But our position is simply that in Villegas, this court did establish that for cases arising from this jurisdiction, applicants must prove a specific intent on the part of state actors and non-state actors. But what Villegas doesn't say, and what this court has most recently recognized in Guerra v. Barr, is that Villegas doesn't say that mental health care workers, that you can never find that they have a specific intent to inflict pain and suffering. And whereas here, the IJ actually makes the finding that in fact, the conduct that's at issue here that Jesus fears will occur to him does rise to the level of torture. It's simply whether they have an intent to inflict that pain and suffering. And here that analysis is not being, the IJ is not even engaging in that analysis. The board itself, when we raise this argument to the board, agrees that the IJ doesn't even need to undertake that analysis. And that is not what Villegas holds. What Villegas holds is that you do need to still look to the direct and circumstantial evidence, that you can't wipe away any of the reasonable inferences that any reasonable fact finder needs to draw from this type of record evidence. And Your Honor, I see that my time is coming to an end, but if there's no further questions from the court, I'd like to reserve my time for rebuttal.
All right, you may reserve the remainder of the time from rebuttal, and we'll hear now from Ms. Corliss.
Good morning. May it please the court, Lindsay Corliss, the respondent. This court should deny the petition for review. Now, there are two issues before the court today, the particularly serious crime determination and the denial of CAT deferral. I'll start with the particularly serious crime issue. Now, in this case, the agency was tasked with determining whether Mr. Villegas' conviction for possession of a concealed dirk or dagger constituted a particularly serious crime. And after noting that it was not a per se particularly serious crime, then properly moved on to the second half of the analysis and NAM to determine whether the underlying circumstances of the commission of that crime rendered it particularly serious.
Evidence in the record that the dagger was used in any way in connection with the kicking of the bicycle?
There is no evidence of that.
Okay, and is there any evidence in the record that the kicking of the bicycle resulted in any harm or risk of harm to the bicycle owner?
There's certainly no evidence that he was harmed. I suppose that inherent in the statute of conviction, there was the risk of harm. He had this concealed dagger, one of the elements.
Possession of the weapon. And the weapon had nothing to do with the assault on the bicycle. So I'm having a hard time seeing how the bicycle kick is relevant conduct to the charge of possession of the concealed dagger.
It's part of the circumstances that were underlying the event. And that's what they're supposed to be looking at. What happened? What exactly was going on when he committed this crime? Now, I understand that this court could very well look at the exact same facts and say, that wasn't particularly serious. I don't think that was. But so it's a discretionary determination. And what this court has to do is see, did the agency abuse its discretion? Well, did it review the...
Can we review the substantive determination or exercise of discretion even for abuse of discretion?
Yes, you can review it for abuse of discretion, but mostly what you're going to be looking at is, did they review the evidence in the record, the sorts of evidence that they were supposed to review, which is also what petitioner has argued as well. Petitioner is arguing they committed legal error by reviewing or not reviewing two things. And I can address those in a second. But the petitioner is not arguing that this court should go through all these factors and decide on its own whether or not this court thinks that this was particularly serious. Because, reasonable minds can differ as far as what is a discretionary, particularly serious crime. But that's reweighing the evidence just isn't within the province of the court and for this sort of a finding. Now, petitioner's two arguments have to do with their assertions that legal error occurred in the analysis. The first is that they are arguing that the agency should not have considered that he was carrying a dirk or dagger at the time of this event, because petitioner himself testified that he wasn't carrying a dirk or dagger. However, the agency was acting well within its discretion for considering the actual elements of the crime to which he pled to. That is, matter of NAM states that the nature of the crime itself, of the conviction, is a relevant factor to analyze. So, and I also just want to note, in the credibility finding that the immigration judge made, as petitioner's counsel has alluded to, this person had mental health issues, and there was an agreement that certain procedural safeguards would be in effect. And one was that the immigration judge would accept the subjective belief that he faces this harm, and And so therefore the credibility standards were a little bit different. And so she says when she finds him credible, he didn't seem to remember some of his criminal history, but overall I'll find that he was credible because he didn't seem to remember that. So she doesn't fault him for the contradictory testimony when she makes it this particularly serious crime finding. Instead she just says, I'm going to essentially agree with the conviction records instead of your statement
The problem that I have is that the conduct that is the basis of the finding of particularly serious crime has nothing to do with the possession of the knife, which is the only thing that is there is a conviction for. So
what matter of NAM is getting to is the fact that many people will commit a crime and what they plead to or what they're sentenced to is or sentenced for having committed doesn't really get to the scope of their acts. And so you need to get to the scope of their acts to find out whether or not what they did was necessarily, serious. Well, this isn't a categorical. Sorry.
Let me ask you about that in terms of they will plead to a crime without. And what they plead to doesn't go to the scope of their acts. Well, do we have actually any evidence here that this gentleman actually possessed a dirk or a dagger?
Well, so we have his plea,
but
that they consider.
I mean, prosecutors all the time cut deals where people will plead to things that they didn't do so that they don't get charged with a more serious offense. I mean, is there anything actually in the record that says there was a dirk or dagger?
He states so the answer is no. Is there any hard evidence that was true? No, but we have that he pled to it. He has his statement in the record that the victim said that accused him of having threatened to kill him and having the weapon. And he said that there was probable cause for the prosecutor to prosecute him for this.
Was there evidence here that he actually brandished the weapon in this episode?
That's not in the record. We don't have a police report or anything like that. We just have his statements, and he did not state that he did. And I will say it's certainly reasonable to disagree with the immigration judge and say, if we don't have evidence that he brandished this weapon, that's not enough. But disagreeing as a matter of judgment doesn't mean that they necessarily erred as a matter of law in making this finding. They didn't make this finding that he possessed the dirk or dagger from nothing. They looked at the elements of the actual crime. Matter of NAM is clear that one of the considerations is the actual crime to which the petitioner has actually pled. So it was a reasonable factor for the immigration judge to consider whether or not we ultimately agree with the immigration judge that he had the dirk or dagger.
Under California state court, does a trial court have to make factual findings to accept the NOLO?
To be honest, I don't know procedurally how that is done in California. Sorry. So unless there are any questions, I'll just wrap up that the immigration judge and the as affirmed by the board relied on the sentence, which was significant. It was one day shy of the absolute maximum sentence that could have been given. They relied on the testimony himself. He said that he assaulted somebody who was totally unknown for him without any provocation at all. And they relied on the fact that his plea indicates that he, in fact, was carrying a stabbing weapon at the time that this occurred. And now, unless there are any more questions on the particularly serious crime finding, I'll move on to the CAT deferral finding. So substantial evidence supported the agency's factual conclusion that Villegas failed to establish his eligibility for CAT deferral. Now, Villegas in this case based his CAT deferral claim on three separate claims. And just for now, I'm going to set aside the gang-related crime because the particulars of that were not discussed except to the extent that they are claiming that it, when considered in the aggregate, it would kind of tip the scales. But as far as the other two claims, this is claims that he's going to be tortured while in some inside of a psychiatric institution or while he's in prison. Both of those claims rely on a chain of interrelated hypothetical events. So specifically, he is stating that he will first be unable to get mental health treatment or would abuse substances in Mexico, leading to his acting out or attracting the attention of authorities. Second, that the authorities would then involuntarily commit him to a psychiatric institution or he would be imprisoned. And then third, that while he was institutionalized or in prison, that he would be tortured. Now, in order for him to succeed on his claim, he would have to establish the probability of each one of those events happening. But at each link in that chain, he fails. And as petitioner noted, there's a lot of evidence on mental health treatment and facilities that are in the record. Both parties submitted a lot of evidence. And the immigration judge cited to a lot of the evidence in the record, but I just like to highlight to the court what petitioner's expert, Mr. Matthew Smith, testified to, because he was put on in court to kind of synthesize that evidence and also really give an explanation based on his own expertise. And you will see, based on petitioner's own expert's testimony, that he repeatedly stated that he didn't meet the probability threshold on any one of those steps. I just want to highlight the one step that he's the most clear about, that petitioner never met the probability of, is that he would be involuntarily institutionalized in Mexico. You can see on page 306 of the record, during Mr. Smith's testimony, he emphasizes that the vast majority of people who are involuntarily institutionalized have been either dropped off or otherwise intentionally abandoned by their families. Now, in this case, a petitioner has stated that both of his grandmothers live in Mexico and that he would live with his maternal grandmother if he were to live in Mexico. He's also stated that he has an aunt there and he has several cousins there. There's no evidence that he lacks the kind of familial support that would prevent him from being institutionalized. Now, Mr. Smith goes on, and it's a theme that he goes back to. He's saying it's very expensive to provide 24-hour round-the-clock care to people in a psychiatric hospital. We're talking just the housing, the food, and the medical treatment. And what the officials in Mexico would much rather do is have families provide that kind of care and not have to institutionalize them. In fact, Mr. Smith was specifically asked on page 319 of the record whether or not he could say that there's a probability that if Mr. Villegas acted out because of a lack of medical treatment, that he would be involuntarily institutionalized. And he explicitly stated that he could not say that there would be a probability of him being committed to a psychiatric hospital. He stated that is not common. So the claim can fail right there, and this court need not get into any of the issues about whether or not specific intent is required by Villegas in this in order to prove torture. So that alone can end this inquiry. And to back up, since I had mentioned that Mr. Smith undermines each one of those links in that chain of hypotheticals, I also just wanted to mention that he discusses that Mexico has a public health care option for any individual who lacks social security. That the main problem in for people obtaining treatment tends to be a lack of diagnosis. And here we have a person who has a diagnosis, and he is aware of the particular kind of care that he would seek. And also that he was asked on page 323 to discuss private mental health facilities that would be where Villegas could voluntarily seek treatment. And when asked directly by petitioner's counsel at the time whether at least 50% of people receiving those services receive adequate care, he answered in the affirmative. So he is saying that if petitioner seeks out treatment in Mexico, he can be treated. So that's another link in that hypothetical chain that is also broken. And I will just, I guess I will finally sum up by saying that the final
response on their argument that the agency violated matter of JRRA in terms of how it used the testimony of Mr. Villegas?
You will see that the way that I think that the specific thing that petitioner is taking issue with is petitioner's statement that he would not abuse, that he would not use marijuana or smoke spice in Mexico. Now, certainly the immigration judge was supposed to be taking some of his testimony with a grain of salt. However, there is absolutely nothing in the record that could have established that he would have continued to use marijuana or smoke spice. He didn't describe a long-lasting, you know, reliance that he was unable to get past. He stated that he stopped smoking marijuana. I'm sorry, can I answer your question? I see that I'm out of time. Oh, I'll just finish answering. He stated that he smoked spice 8 times, and the reason he had done so was because he knew that marijuana would show up on a drug test, and he didn't want to fail his drug test, whereas I guess spice doesn't show up on a drug test. So, you know, like, he is describing events that indicate that he has some control over whether or not he's going to be taking these drugs or abusing these substances. And there's no evidence in the record showing that he will continue to abuse those substances. So when faced with his assertion that he's not going to abuse substances in Mexico against no evidence that he will abuse substances in Mexico, the IJ acted reasonably in accepting the only evidence that was in the record, which was his testimony. Now I see that my time is up. So unless there are any more questions. Oh, thank you so much.
All right. Thank you, counsel. So we'll hear now rebuttal from Ms. Soni.
Yes, Your Honor. Thank you so much. I'd like to just begin really quickly with the CAT arguments, and primarily with the due process. I mean, here again, we've heard from the government. They don't provide any sort of reasonable basis for why the IJ granted the safeguard that she would not rely on his testimony and then reneged and ultimately relied on his testimony on these critical aspects of his claim, both for purposes of CAT and for PSC. That is a due process error that requires remand, because but for that reliance, the outcome would most certainly be different. Second, Your Honor, with respect to the argument here that the government has offered with respect to aggregation and pointing out the different sort of probabilities for purposes of meeting his burden with respect to torture in mental health institutions and for each potential source of torture. Well, this error stems from the application of applying matter of JFF to a claim like this that involves multiple sources of torture. This court has repeatedly held and had to remand where the agency makes the type of error that they've made here, which is to apply this chain of events requiring the person to demonstrate that each chain of event would more likely than not occur when you're involving multiple sources of torture. As our brief shows, when you apply that matter of JFF to multiple sources of torture, it lends to absurd results. And third, with respect to Mr. Smith's testimony and what he has said, as well as the evidence that corroborates his testimony, the government is, again, misstating the testimony and taking it out of context. Mr. Smith unequivocally stated that Jesus would end up, it's more likely than not that he would end up in one of the three facilities that engages in the chemical and physical restraints that the IJ found rises to the level of torture. The only question then remains is whether they have a specific intent. And for the reasons that we argued previously, the specific intent finding on this record wasn't made because of the agency's over-reliance on Villegas in matter of JRGP as precluding it from needing to engage in that inquiry. And so those reasonable inferences were not made. Finally, that leads me to the PSC, Your Honor. And Your Honor is absolutely right. There's no, if The agency needed here to be bound to its own precedent that requires that they do a threshold inquiry. That threshold inquiry means looking at the conviction and asking whether this conviction falls within that ambit. When you're doing that inquiry, you do not look at the facts and circumstances. So whether he kicked the person's bike or not was actually irrelevant to that inquiry. Here, the inquiry was never done, and that's another reason why this court should please remand. With that, Your Honor, if there's no further questions, we would submit on our papers.
I thank counsel for their arguments in this case, and the case of Villegas-Gomez versus Garland will be submitted.
Have a nice day.